It's from the book of Galatians chapter 3, Paul's letter to the church in Galatia. We've been working our way through Paul's letter for several weeks now, and we find ourselves near the end of chapter 3. It should be found on page 973 in the Bibles in front of you, or it's also printed in your bulletins. You can follow along there. Galatians chapter 3, we'll begin reading with verse 21 and read almost to the end through verse 27. Galatians 3, beginning with verse 21, hear the word of the Lord. Is the law, then, contrary to the promises of God? Certainly not, Megenitoi. For if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. But the Scripture imprisoned everything under sin, so that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. Now before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned, until the coming faith would be revealed. So then, the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. So far, the reading of God's word. I encourage you to keep your Bibles open or your bulletins open to Galatians chapter 3, because we're going to be referring to it a number of times this morning. Well, friends, many of us are very thankful for our parents, and they have been great blessings to us. Not everyone can say that. Sometimes there's great conflict and great hurt, but at some level, most of us, there's this desire, we don't know where it comes from, where we seek the blessing of our parents, and especially our fathers. Even if we don't articulate it, there's something inside of us that says, I really need my parents, my father, to say, well done. I'm proud of you. I'm proud of what you've become and what you've accomplished. And if we don't get that blessing, if we're always seeking that approval, there's something that's missing and something that it really winds us up and not in a good way. Because there's in many of us that seeking the blessing of our fathers. Well, I think to the extent that that's there, it's probably a reflection of how God has made us. Because as image bearers of God, at some level, even though the image has been distorted by the fall and we are rebels now, there's still that innate desire to seek the blessing of our Father in heaven. We are going to see that as sinners, we are never going to get that blessing on our own. But we will see how it's possible to get the greatest blessing from our Father in heaven this morning. Well, we certainly don't start off with good news in our text, right? In fact, we get a great big dose of really bad news in Galatians. Galatians chapter 3 has been it's been a wake-up call, because we've read already that God has actually not just not blessed us, but God has cursed us. Everyone, we are born with the curse of God. Why is that? Well, because we are lawbreakers. And we're not just little bit lawbreakers. Galatians chapter 3, verse 10, you can go back to that if your Bible's open. We saw this a few weeks ago. All who rely on the works of the law, we are under God's curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who doesn't continue to do everything written in the book of the law. That's very sobering, isn't it? God doesn't grade on a curve. It says that he curses everyone who doesn't continually do everything in the law. That's a little bit sobering, and it's a shock, especially how we normally think. And yet we need to hear God's verdict, because In our sinful nature, we're constantly justifying ourselves. We're always comparing ourselves to our neighbor, and we say, we're not as bad as that person. We see this all throughout Scripture, right? The rich young ruler, when he was speaking with Jesus, he heard what God's law required, and what did he first say? He said, oh, I've kept all these laws. Matthew 19. And so Galatians reminds us that we need a perfect, perpetual obedience to all of God's laws. And anything short of perfection brings God's curse. The law is the great standard. And so verses 24 and 25 in our text tell us that we need to pay attention to God's law. Let's read verses 24 and 25 again. We read there, so then the law, God's law, was our guardian until Christ came in order that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. The law is our guardian, it says, or our tutor, as other translations give us. The Greek word is paedagogos. And the tutor instructs us, gives us tests, grades us, shows us how we fall short, and then gives us more work to tell us that, you know, we need to keep making progress, right? That's what a tutor does. Although we don't really have much experience with tutors, perhaps an imperfect analogy, and it's not what the Greek word means here, but perhaps a physical trainer might be something that we understand more today. Now, a physical trainer, if you hire someone, they are going to monitor your diet, they are going to monitor your exercise, and they are going to tell you what you're doing wrong and what you need to improve. And they're constantly telling you what you're doing wrong, and they're constantly telling you how you can improve, right? They're on your case. Well, that's sort of what the law does. And the more we study God's law, the more areas in our lives we see need work. We see this at Jesus' summary of the law in Matthew 22, right? Matthew 22, someone said, teacher, what is the greatest of the commandments? There's so many laws. What's the greatest? And you remember what he said? The first and the greatest commandment is this, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. We hear from Matthew 5, what we read earlier, that not only does God require us to love him with everything we've got all the time, but Matthew 5 tells us that we need to do this perfectly, be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect, and that we will not see the kingdom of heaven unless our righteousness is a perfect righteousness. So the more we hear about God's righteous standards and God's holiness, what do we learn? We see that we are, in fact, cursed. That's what Galatians 3:10 says. And we deserve God's curse. Verse 22 in our text, God's scripture, God's law, has shown us our sin and thrown us into prison. Verse 23, if I could paraphrase it, God's law has thrown us into jail, and we are now kept under lock and key. So the law not only shows us God's standard, it shows us how far short we fall, and it reminds us that we are under the curse of God. And the more we reflect on the law, we see we really deserve that curse, because there's a huge chasm between God's holiness and our lack of righteousness, our sin. The bad news is, in fact, really bad from Galatians. We are cursed by God. We are, to paraphrase, suffering in jail. And jail back in Paul's day was not a very nice place. Didn't have air conditioning and flat screen TVs. We are suffering in jail. The law puts us in prison. And we are under lock and key, and we're not getting out. So Galatians, now you might, if you're visiting, you're probably thinking, wow, okay, so this is an interesting church. We start the sermon with some really bad news and very sobering news. That's true. That's what the scriptures say, and that's what a holy God requires. But Paul, in the book of Galatians, doesn't just tell us this bad news, but we also get wonderful news, or gospel, the good message. And the gospel in Galatians answers the law's bad news. Remember that little Greek word huper, that we see that verse after verse, that Christ has acted in our place. The good news is that Christ is our substitute. He has suffered God's wrath that we should have suffered. Just going back to Galatians 3, verse 13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, huper, on our behalf. Chapter 2, verse 20, we read there that the Son of God loved me and gave himself on behalf of me, on behalf of my sins. He gave himself up in my place. So we've seen message of hope in Galatians, right? Christ has taken on himself our curse from God so as to remove God's curse from us. That's the good news. But now, let's step back and we've got some new territory to cover. That was all old review. As we look at the law of God, since it is our tutor, right? The one that instructs us. What if the law really, really does a great job as our personal trainer? And what if the more we meditate on the law, we see more and more how vile we are, especially in light of God's holiness? If it truly sinks in, God requires perfection, and we can't even be perfect for 10 minutes. What then? Yes, Christ has taken our punishment, but what about the eternal principles of justice, God's justice? In chapter 3, verse 12, we read this. The man who keeps the law deserves to live. By the way, that quote's from the Old Testament, from Leviticus chapter 18, verse 5. Let me read Leviticus 18, verse 5. You shall therefore keep my statutes and my rules. If a person does them, he shall live by them. I am the Lord Yahweh. The law's standards don't go away. So yes, the good news is that Christ has removed the curse from us, but what about the blessing of God? Just getting rid of the bad, that's nice, but what about can we expect to have the blessing of God? It's nice not to have the curse, but you and I know there's a difference between someone not cursing you, that's good, but there's a difference between not cursing and actually blessing. How can we hope to have the blessing of God? Now, the gospel, again, is good in that Christ as our substitute removes the curse. But what about the blessing? Well, this is where Galatians 3, in our text, opens up even more good news. The really good news about Jesus Christ is not only is he your substitute taking God's curse and wrath when you trust in him, not only do you gain Christ as your substitute through faith, not anything you do, but only through trusting, but the great news in our text is that Jesus Christ makes you righteous and holy in God's sight. How? Friends, let me tell you something that the Reformed faith has defined and not just in an intellectual sense, but has embraced, which is precious, but which I suspect some of you have never heard. I grew up in a Christian Reformed church. I never heard this taught clearly, and it was terrible. The good news that you need to hear from Galatians 3, our text, is called the active obedience of Christ. Some of you, I probably have never heard that term. You think, the active obedience of Christ, what in the world are you talking about? I think this is the most neglected part of the gospel. It's very common to hear, when you do hear a gospel preaching church, it's common to hear about Christ as our substitute, who stands in our place, takes the wrath of God, removing the curse. That's great. That's important. That is the gospel. But there's another part to the gospel that's just as important that you probably haven't heard. But Paul thinks it's important, and it's part of Paul's gospel. And what is the act of obedience of Christ? It's this. It's the fact that Christ, when he was on this earth 2,000 years ago, Jesus perfectly kept all of the commandments of God. You know that? Jesus perfectly kept the commandments. Now, how do you know that? Well, Jesus doesn't always make those claims for himself. He does say it once in a while. He says, "Who of you can accuse me of sin? No one." But it's more important that the Father says that about his Son, that Jesus has kept all the law, right? And so we go to the gospel in Matthew chapter 3. This isn't all the gospels, but I'm just going to read some of the text. In Matthew 3, verse 17, after Jesus was baptized, what do we read there? When Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were open. He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, and behold, listen to this, a voice from heaven said, what? "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." The Father said about the Son, "Not only do I love him, but I am well pleased with him." Would he be well pleased with Jesus if he had missed a few commandments? No. What's the penalty for disobeying? It's curse, right? And yet the Father says of the Son, "With him I am well pleased." Is that just a one-time deal that the Father said that? No. What about near on the Mount of Transfiguration? Matthew 17, verse 5. What do we read there? And he was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud, who's that? It's the Father, who said this, "This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased." Listen to him. John chapter 17, verse 4. What does Jesus say? He says, "I have glorified you on earth, Father, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do." I have accomplished your work. I have kept your commandments. And finally, at the end of Jesus' life on this earth, in Matthew 28, verse 18, what does he say? Jesus says, "All authority on heaven and on earth has been," what? "Given to me by the Father." Friends, over and over we read that Christ kept the commandments. Christ was not only beloved of the Father, but the Father was well pleased with him. Not just pleased, well pleased. And the obedience of Christ to the commandments merited the approval and favor of God the Father. That's why we hear the "well done." "With you, Son, I am well pleased." Now, what does that have to do with you and me? Well, let's read what Galatians chapter 3, verse 27 says. Galatians 3, 27. "For as many of you as were baptized into Christ, you have put on Christ." The good news is that Christ credits his obedience to you when you trust in him. If you trust in him, you are baptized in him, you are joined to Christ, as it were, spiritually. And here I actually have a problem with the ESV again. Every week I'm finding things with the ESV. Verse 27 mistakenly says, "For as many of you who were baptized into Christ have put on Christ." For as many as you were baptized into Christ, it literally says, you have clothed yourselves with Christ.
That's what the New American Standard does. That's what the NIV says. That's what the Greek says. If you are baptized into Christ, it says literally that you are clothed with Christ. What does that mean? Now, this is all in context. What's Paul talking about in Galatians 3? He's talking about law, right? He's talking about the law being our tutor, the law revealing God's righteousness. It's in that context of God speaking about obeying the law that he then says, in Christ, you are baptized into him and you are clothed with Christ. This is talking about the righteousness of God that Christ has merited. The law instructs us in the holy ways of God. The law shows what pleases God. The law shows us how to receive the blessing of God. The problem is we can't get it done because of our sinfulness. The good news is that Christ secures the blessings of God by perfectly keeping the commandments. And once Christ perfectly keeps the commandments, he credits or gives his obedience to you and to your account so that you can receive the blessing of God. You see, friends, he doesn't just remove the curse from you as your substitute, but in Christ, if you are in him through faith, he credits his righteousness to you. Literally, you are clothed with Christ. And again, is that talking about you become God like the Mormons teach? No. It's not that you are clothed with his ontological being. You are clothed with his obedience, his law-keeping. And therefore, what does verse 26 say? Let's take a look at verse 26. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. You get that? By the way, does God have some sons that he just has, but he's not really, doesn't like to talk about them, and that's the black sheep of the family? And some of you think, well, we're the black sheep, right? Does God have any sons like that? No. If you are a son of the Father, you're not just a son. You are a beloved son. You are all, it says in verse 26, beloved sons of God if you are in Christ Jesus through faith. And verse 27 reminds us that in Christ Jesus, his perfect obedience covers you for the Holy Father to see. You are clothed with Christ. So that when our Holy Father sees Christ's obedience in you, since you are clothed in Christ's righteousness, our Father says that you are sons. So friends, the good news of the gospel is that if you trust in Christ, you are beloved sons. You are beloved daughters of the King. Just as the voice from heaven pronounced his blessing on Christ, this is my beloved son. If you trust in Christ and you are in him, now the Father says of you, you, this is my beloved daughter. This is my beloved son. And God is well pleased with you because by faith and trusting in Christ, you have Christ's righteousness as your covering. So the gospel isn't just that he's removed the curse. That's great. The gospel is that in Christ Jesus, you have been clothed with Christ's righteousness. And the implications of that are now you have the blessing of God because you've kept the law. The law isn't nullified. The law is fulfilled. But it's fulfilled by Christ. By the way, friends, you're in an Orthodox Presbyterian church. The founder of the OPC, J. Gresham Machen, some of you know this. You should know it. As he was dying, he sent a telegram to his colleague at Westminster Seminary in Philadelphia. And he was dying. He knew he was going to die from pneumonia in the Dakotas. And he said what? His last words were, "Thank God for the active obedience of Christ There's no hope without it. That's precious. And sometimes we don't even know what the active obedience of Christ is. Unfortunately, even in some of our churches, this is denied and neglected. They'll talk about Christ's substitutionary work and getting rid of the curse, but they don't talk about Galatians 3, verse 27. It's great to have the curse removed, but how much it's precious to know that we have the blessing of God and His approval because of Christ's clothing. We are beloved sons and daughters in Christ Jesus. And to the extent that some of our churches and even seminaries ignore this, we're robbing the sheep of Christ of these riches of the gospel. The good news of the gospel is not just Christ as your substitute and all the huper verses that we've gone over, paying for your sins and removing the curse. No, the gospel is also Christ is your righteousness. Clothed with Christ, you are now blessed by our Holy Father. You've been clothed with Jesus. And friends, now in Christ Jesus, you receive the blessing of a holy God. In Christ, with you, I am well pleased. That's good news. And that's the gospel that Paul preaches to each one of us. And it's not just the curses removed. You have the blessing because of Christ. Let's pray.